How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear. The hour I
appreciate you coming today to be with this family, those that are extended from this family and for friends. Thank you for being here today, for your support, for your prayers over this family. We're here to celebrate the life of Doug Eugene Williams. Many people knew him by Douglas, they would call him, and others would just call him Doug. He was born November the 8th, 1958, in Jessup, Georgia. Passed away November the 18th, at the age of 64 years and 10 days. And of course, I'm Pastor Ricky Knox, but I was Doug's second cousin. His dad and I were first cousins. He was born to the late James E. Williams Sr. and Deborah Scott White, and he was a former employee of the Waycross Housing Authority and a member of the Southside Baptist Church here in Waycross. He'd worked many other places in his younger life, and I'm sure made quite a few friends. He was a friendly guy. If you met him one-on-one and talked with him, he could talk to you. In addition, To his parents, he was preceded in death by a sister, Glenda K. Harrison. Survived by one son, David, one grandson, Presley, siblings, James E. Jr., we all call him Jimmy, Drenda, husband Romero, sister, Brenda Morris, Janie Williams, and James E. or Scooby Williams. Special nieces is Nikki, Tasha, and Jonathan, and Abril. His wife, Lisa. Seven stepchildren, Ty, Savannah, Angeles, Stephen, Philippi, Darla, and Abby, Miranda. Right. Okay. Big family in one sense, but a small family in another sense. But I'm so thankful that we're here as a family to celebrate his homegoing. And I want to go to the Lord in prayer. And I know your hearts are heavy and hurting over the sadness, but we also can think of the joy of the Lord that we can ask him for his strength and his comfort today. Precious Father, we come before you on behalf of this service and this family. We thank you, Lord, for the love that we can feel in this family. We thank you for the faith that we see out of so many in this family that love you. We thank you for the life, Lord, of Doug, and the life that he lived, the faith that he had in you, Lord. God, we thank you, Lord, for his family that you blessed and allowed him to be a part of and to share his life with. And we ask your guidance upon this service here, Lord, that whatever said and done, that it would minister strength and comfort, God, and give encouragement to each one that is in this chapel today, that you may become the Lord and Savior of each of our lives, Lord, and all that we do. There's not one here that doesn't know you, Lord, as a personal Lord and Savior, that they'll make that commitment today. But I'm thankful that we have you to lean upon and to find that comfort and strength. And so we ask now that you direct this service, that your name be glorified. In the name of Christ we ask. Amen.
I saw a red bird flying high out of a sunset sky. I saw a sunflower growing wild on that old roadside. Clear as a lighthouse beacon, I could see that you're not that far away, far away. When I need you, you'll be right outside my window. Feel your arms around me when the wind blows. I still think you left too soon, but I'm thankful for your time. 'Cause heaven's lucky to have you, so was I. I wish I could call you up. I mess up one of Grandma's recipes. I wish we could catch up on life and such and hear you laughing at me. But today I found a picture, saw that smile upon your face. I knew everything would be okay. When I need you, you'll be right outside my window. Arms around me when the wind blows. I still think you left too soon, but I'm thankful for your time. 'Cause heaven's lucky to have you, so was I. When I need you, you'll be right outside my window. I feel your arms around me when the wind blows. I still think you left too soon, but I'm thankful for your time. 'Cause heaven's lucky to have you. God knows how much I miss you. Heaven's lucky to have you. So was I. So was I. I could see angels' faces when they hear your sweet voice sing. So go rest high on that mountain, son, you are.
Let me first say thank you to Jimmy and Drenda, David, for allowing me to speak here today on behalf of Doug's homegoing service. Lisa, thank you. He was a personal friend as well as a cousin. Doug was a country boy. He was a country boy. You saw some of the pictures. He loved horses, motorcycles, loved old cars. Brother Eddie and I were talking in the back before the service. Used to have an old orange cougar. I don't know if he kept it. And if he used to keep it out in the garage or something. But anyway, he liked old cars. And most of all, he liked and loved his family. He loved you. And I know you loved him as well. But above all things of what he liked and loved, there was no doubt about his love for his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He and I have talked many, many hours about the Lord. Many hours through the years. Doug was a skater when he was a young boy. My dad was the youngest out of six siblings, and many times they would come to our house. All the kin folks would, the first cousins. There was about 40 of the grandchildren out of the six siblings, and they would come to our house pretty much for Easter and Thanksgiving, and a lot of times we'd have cane grinding and other things we'd do. But I knew Doug vaguely. But when he was about 12 and I was 15, my mom and dad divorced, and we moved into projects over in Kingsland. And Doug was already living in the projects at that time. Deborah had moved in. And so he was about 12 and I was 15. I was 3 years over Doug. And we become real strong friends. I never could skate as good as him. That boy could skate. Now, I could skate good forward, but not backwards. And he would help so many. We lived about two blocks from the skating ring there in Kingsland. And he could skate. And he would teach so many people that would bring their children wanting to learn how to skate. And Doug would help them to learn how to skate. And before you know it, they'd be on their own doing their own thing. But he loved that grandbaby, too. He loved that grandbaby. And it's always sad and difficult to lose a loved one during Thanksgiving and Christmas. The reason is it's special times that we come together as families. And, of course, we share our thankfulness. Most of all, Jimmy, to God, our Creator, who has, through his mercy and grace, has given us the privilege to breathe the breath that we breathe and to live. And also at Christmas time, when we come together and share. And I'm thankful that we can celebrate still in this country the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ coming into this world. Now, many still celebrate him as a child at Christmas time. But he didn't remain a child. He grew up and lived some 33 and a half years on this earth. And he walked before those of this world and handpicked 12 men that he taught them the ways of his heavenly Father and what his Father had sent him to do. And after 33 and a half years, he laid down his life for the sin of this world so that you and I might be able to have direct communication between our Creator and us. He provided that for us in giving his life. And many on this earth today know him as Lord and Savior, and there's still many that do not know him as Lord and Savior. Recently I said It's one thing to have an acquaintance of someone. It's another thing to know them personally. There's a lot of people I have acquaintance with. I know their name and their face, but I know very little about them. But I know much about my Lord because He's my personal Savior. He's my personal Lord. And He wants to be that for you today. You see, He had taught those 12 men that He handpicked. He taught them how to live a life that was set apart in this world, different from how the world would live. When He came into the world, there was about 10 sects, 10 groups of people that were doing their own thing. Why didn't He join one of them? Because they didn't have the truth. They were not living the truth. The basis of their religion, the basis of things that they done was not built on the truth of what His Father declared to be true and holy. And Jesus set forth that from His life or by His life to those 12 men and shared with them, when I leave this life, you carry on this new covenant that I have come and brought to you, this gospel that I want you to declare to the world. You see, between the Old Testament and the New Testament, there was 400 years of silence. God didn't have no prophet. He didn't have no priest. He didn't have no one that was His mouthpiece. And according to Proverbs 14 and 12, man did what was right in his own eyes. But the thing that was wrong with man doing what was wrong in his own eyes was the very fact that his way was the ways of death. But the way of God is the way of life, or the gift of life that He has to offer every man on this earth. And so He didn't join those 10 groups of people that were doing their thing because their way was corrupt. Many of their ways was evil. And it was not in line with God's truth and His word. So when He set forth those 12 men and said, now I'll build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And He said, when I leave here, you're to carry on the work. And of course, aren't you thankful today that that work has been a continuation that you and I have been able to pick it up and to carry on that work today of our Lord and Savior. I've been in the ministry about 48 years trying to share the gospel with souls, and I'm concerned myself every day about having a personal relationship with Him. A personal relationship. Not an acquaintance, but I know who He is. Doug had a personal relationship with the Lord. The hours that he and I would talk, many times over the phone, a few times in person. But many times we would talk on the phone. He would call me, or I would call him, and it'd be hard to get off the phone with him. We'd start talking about various things. He may say something about his family or something else, but very soon we would begin talking about the Lord and about His goodness and His blessings. And I always enjoyed that. Enjoyed that time of fellowship that I would have with Doug. So this celebration today is about his homegoing. You see, if you establish a personal relationship, then Jesus says you will never die. That when you leave this life, you will take up a new life. Ain't that wonderful? I know your hearts are grieving. Your heart, David, is sad for the loss of your dad. But the thing about the loss and the sadness that you have in your heart, if you know anything of the Word of God and what God declares in His Word, you can go to where He has prepared Himself to go. And we all can go. Aren't you glad when Jesus said, whosoever will? He didn't say, I'll just choose a select few and that's it. But He said, whosoever will believe on me shall receive eternal life. Oh, I'm telling you, We live in by God's grace and mercy today, Matt. Every breath that we take, we should be thankful for. Amen. Everyone that's in our life, we should be grateful for. That God has allowed us to be part of each other's life and share with one another. Because this life here is short. It's a few years. 60, 70, 80. The scripture says 70 it's given to man, which is 70 years. And of course, many are living up pretty much to 85 today, many people, with all the health, medical care that has been given people today. They're living a lot longer lives. Of course, the cemetery is filled with many sizes of graves, very small all the way to the elderly. But there's one thing for certain. We have the opportunity and the privilege to come and know the one that created us and put us here for a reason, for a purpose, to know him, that we might give our life to him. And many people walk through this life and never acknowledge that they need him. He's merciful and he's a just God. And he will never force himself for you to serve him. He's laid it out before us through his word. And by his spirit, he will prick your heart and he'll say, I want you. I love you. I sent my son to die for you. And if you will acknowledge that you need him, that you need a savior, that you're lost, you can be saved. You can be born again. You can know the very one that created you and why he created you. It's sad to know that God has created, they just said, a census of somewhere around a little over 8 billion people in the world. That's a big consensus of how many people's in the world. But it's a small, small number that actually know their Creator, the one that made them and give them life. And has given you and me the next breath that we breathe. If he was to withhold breath from you the next moment, you wouldn't be here, neither would I. We would be here where Doug is today. But thank God Doug answered that call that come out to him. You see, the Lord was never lost when he came into this world. He came to seek and save that which is lost. And that was you and I. That was man on this earth. And when he pricked Doug's heart one day, I don't know exactly what age that he gave his heart to the Lord, but that was the best day of his life. The best day of my life was not when I was born to Junior and Merle Jean Knox. The best day of my life, even though I thank God for that, I thank God that he used them as the means to bring me into the world. But the greatest thing that's ever happened to me upon being born into this world was when I was born again. When I acknowledged that I needed a Savior, that I needed a Lord, that I was born again. And when I repented of my sins, and that's all we have to do. See, God has made it so simple. He's not made it hard for any person on this earth to be saved. He's made it very simple. It ain't like you've got to go out and kill 6,000 goats or sheep and go, you know, and go have their blood and bring it before and minister. And I tell the church sometimes, some of my members, I said, aren't you glad you didn't have to get up this morning and go kill a bunch of the flocks and come and bring the blood so I could go into the Holy of Holies and offer the sacrifice up before I could minister to you today? See, he made it so simple that all we have to do is to acknowledge him. We're told in Romans 10:10, said, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness. And with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Simple, isn't it? That's not hard to do. God made it so simple. He took all the hard work out of it for you and I. Amen. And some many years ago, Doug received his Lord and Savior. He made that confession. I'm so thankful today because it's not hard for me to stand up here at this podium today and declare to you about his life because I knew a good bit about his life. And I knew the person that he was. And I knew how much he loved his Lord. How much he loved him. What his faith was in his Lord. We're told in Romans 3 and 23, it says, "For all have sinned." Now that scripture is used in the means of past tense, not in the present. It said, "We all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." You see, there may be some ministers that are standing today and tell you this lie that you can't live in this world without sinning. That you're going to live here every day, you're going to sin. Well, if I can't live without sinning, I'm a sinner and you're a sinner and he's a sinner. In John, the book of John, he said, "He that sinneth is of the devil." But that's why Jesus Christ came into the world. To give his life a ransom for many, that whoever would believe on him should have everlasting life. Whoever would confess him could receive that life eternal. Now I don't have it. I have the hope of it. I have the promise of it. I've not yet received it. But Doug has received his. Within seconds, I'm sure, Drinda, after he took his last breath, he was with the Lord. The scripture says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Amen. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You see, I don't have to sin. You don't have to sin. Somebody might tell you that we do, but don't you believe that lie. You know what sin is? The scripture bears it out in the book of Romans so plainly. Because Romans is the roadmap to salvation. It'll give you the clear understanding of what it is, of what sin is. It's a willful transgression against the law of God. So if I get up in the morning, I've got to say, well, I'm going to willfully transgress against God today. I'm going to go against what His law says, what His word says. I'm going to go against Him. And if I do, I'll sin. But I don't have to get up and do that. I get up calling on my Lord and my Savior. Help me today walk through this life, Lord. Help me to be the light that you want me to be. Help me to love those around me and minister your word to a lost and hurting world. Help me to share the gospel. See, all have sinned and come short of the glory. He said, what happened is all have sinned and come short of the honor or the worship of God our Father. When we come into this world, we were born into this world of sin. The psalmist David said, "In sin did my mother conceive me." Born into this world in sin. We come short of worship and honor of our God. We're told in Romans 6 and 23, said, "The wages of sin is death." That's what the pay for sin is. It's death. But he says, "But the gift of God." This is what sounds good. This is what sounds good to each of us. But the gift of God. God has something to give you today if you don't know Him. He has something He wants to offer you today if you don't know Him. Said, but the gift of God is eternal life. That sounds a lot better, don't it, than death. Did you know the truth is there's a lot of people living in this world today that don't know the Lord. They're just dead men. Walking in dead bones, waiting for time to expire, that if they don't accept their Lord, the only future they have is a hell that's been prepared for the devil and his angels. Amen. See, we have opportunity to prepare, to offer Him praise, to offer Him worship, because when we say Christ our Lord, when we receive that gift of eternal life through Christ, our Lord, when you speak about the word Lord, do you know how many times the word Lord is in God's word in the Old Testament and the New Testament? Over 8,000 times. over 8,000 times in the Old and the New Testament is the word Lord used in the Bible. And it's put there for the purpose that we would recognize that He is our Creator, that He's our Adonai. Yes, He is. He's the Supreme One that's in authority. Not man, but He is. He's self-existent. He's eternal. He's the Mighty One, the Divine One. He wants to be our counselor and our guide, if we'll let Him. People today are asking on the earth what the rich young ruler and what Nicodemus had come to Jesus and asked. In the third chapter of John, Nicodemus come to Jesus by night and he said, "Good master," he said, "what must I do to inherit life eternal?" And he said, "Why do you call me good?" He said, "There's none good but one, the Father." So simple, so easy. He said, "I tell you, marvel not at this, Nicodemus. Listen to this, you must be born again." "What, me?" Nicodemus said, "Me born again?" He said, "Can I be born a second time? Can I enter my mother's womb and be born again?" He said, "Nicodemus, you can't even see the kingdom of God. You don't understand the kingdom of God." Nicodemus was a lawyer. He was a doctor of the law. He was a very educated man. I mean, he was a very highfalutin lawyer in his day of things that he knew. He knew the law, but he did not know who the Lord was. And you see, that's where the scripture says that the carnal mind is enmity. It's hatred against God. That's why we have to be renewed in our minds as well when we come to the Lord to be saved. Our minds are to be renewed, and those things are to take place day after day, a renewing of our mind day after day. And he said, "Nicodemus," he said, "you can't see the kingdom of God. You can't understand what I'm sharing with you. But I'll tell you this. A man is born into this world," said, "he's born of water and of flesh." And he said, "that which is flesh, and that which is spirit, is spirit." He said, "marvel not that I'm telling you, Nicodemus, you must be born again." In other words, don't be amazed at what I'm telling you. You must be born again. And then, of course, the rich young ruler, the last part of this, the rich young ruler, in Matthew, the 19th chapter, he came to the Lord, and he was inquiring about life eternal. And he told him, he said, "what's required? Love God and keep His commandments." He said, "Oh, I've done this from my youth up. I've done it from my youth up." And he spelled out six of the commandments to this rich young ruler. But he left off the very last commandment. And that's what you and I have to deal with today. And so much of our living from day to day. He left off one important thing. He talked about not lying and don't commit adultery and don't murder and honoring your mother and father and don't steal. And, you know, he named off six of commandments. But he left off one. He said the covenant. The things about covet, do not covet. Because a rich young ruler, he had things of his riches that he coveted. And he said, "You lack one thing though." Oh, he was so happy and proud of himself. "I've kept these from my youth up." He said, "You lack one thing." "What is that?" He said, "Go sell what you have and give to the poor." He coveted. See, the thing about the commandments of God talks about covetousness. That's personal. When I talk about lying and committing murder and stealing and adultery, I'm doing something towards someone else. But when I covet something, that's personal. That's something that I'm dealing with, keeping to myself. And Jesus said, go sell what you had and get to the poor. You know what happened to the rich young ruler? And it's still going on today. He went away sorrowful. Went away sorrowful. He had an opportunity to give his life to the Lord, to repent. How many people has ever entered a church house, a church service, and heard the message of the gospel being proclaimed? And they left not giving their heart to the Lord, thinking, I got plenty of time. There'll be another day. We don't know for sure that there will be. I've had many and many services through the years that no one was sick. They were not sick. All of a sudden had a heart attack or stroke, or they were killed in a car accident or some other means. They were shot unexpectedly. They left this life. See, the Lord's given us opportune time to take advantage and not to allow one day to go by without making things right with Him if we don't know Him. Don't you know He loves you? He loves you. He loves me. He loved Doug. And Doug learned to love him back. And that's what made the difference in Doug's life, in connection to Jesus Christ. Amen. And it'll make a difference in your life today, is your relationship with Him. See, He wants a personal relationship, not an acquaintance. Hey, Lord, I go to church. I was there. I was at church service. I heard the preacher preach. Well, did you acknowledge that He's your Creator and that He loves you and He wants to have fellowship with you? He wants a relationship with you. Because if you didn't, you missed the most important thing of you being there in God's house or sitting under God's message. A great opportune time. You know, David, he will never come back, as well as millions and millions of others that's gone on through the years. Never come back. But the psalmist David said something when he lost his child. He'd wept and cried and prayed because he was sick between him and Bathsheba, that he wanted that child to be healed. And that child, Jimmy, was not healed. And he stayed in his chamber. He stayed locked up, doors closed, weeping. Wouldn't even eat, fasted. Was praying for the Lord to heal his child. And he didn't heal his child. And they come to him and said, the child's passed. And he got up and he washed himself. And he put on his garments, his robe. And he went out. And he began to exalt and praise the Lord. He said, I know He can't come back to me, but I can go to be where He is. And that's the thing. You know, I lost my wife a little over a year ago, in a few months, to COVID. That we had been together 41 years. Had the best relationship a husband and wife could ever have. There's no doubt. You know what a relationship is? It's... Oh, that's what you put in it. It's what you put in a relationship. It's how much you're willing to give yourself to a relationship. That's what makes a strong relationship, whether it's husband and wife, husband and children. Nancy, that's what's important. It's important how much we put in that love. That love that we put in that relationship to our children or to our spouses or grandchildren. And our relationship to the Lord. Our relationship to the Lord, what we put in it. You see, some people that are strong men and women, they have strong faith. It's because they've got a strong relationship. They build on it, dreaming every day. They build on that relationship. Just like I build on that relationship with my spouse, my wife, from the very day that we started dating. We dated 3 years before we married. It was such a good dating ordeal. She said, I'd have married you way back yonder if you'd asked me. But we had a good relationship because we both contributed as much as we could to it. And I said several times since she's gone, she was my wife here, but you know in heaven, she won't be my wife. And you know what? She's not an angel. God created angels. We're not angels. We're flesh and blood. She's not an angel looking down from heaven. If she could look down from heaven, all she'd see was sorrow and sadness and sickness and pain and suffering. So she can't look down and see me, nor none of the rest of them can. It's kind of like the rich man and Lazarus says, too great a span, too great a gulf. You can't see. But you know the thing about hell? The rich man that lifted up his eyes in torment, he said, I got five brothers back on the earth. Send someone to warn them that they won't come to this place of torment. And he said, they got the law and the prophets. They won't hear them. They won't hear one that come from the dead. So you know, this morning, we've got loved ones that are gone on to heaven. Jimmy, they've left us. But if we know anything about God's word, we know where they're going to. So they're not lost. They've very much found. And they're there waiting for our time, when our time will be. And I'm planning on making it. And I hope and pray that you will make plans to make it, if you haven't already, that you'll secure things with the Lord. Because it's a daily walk. It ain't just a talk, it's a walk, it's a life change. When we truly repent, that means you turn about face. You don't do the things you used to do. You don't say the things you used to say. You don't go to the places you used to go. You turn about face and you're a different creature. You're a new creature. You separate yourself in this life from the life you used to live as a sinner while you were lost. Let me say to us today as I come to a close, don't let this life slip away from you. Don't let it slip away. Don't let the devil cheat you out of what God has prepared for you to receive if you'll acknowledge him and call out to him. Don't let him cheat you out of this, because he will. He'll cheat you out of it, because he knows that he's doomed. Him and his angels are doomed for a place that's been prepared for them. But it wasn't prepared for you and me. God made a way of escape when he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to this earth. He made a way so that we wouldn't have to go to that place of torment, where the worm dieth not, or where the fire is not quenched, the scripture says, burneth torment forever and ever. I don't plan to go there. I'm making my plans to be with my Lord and my Savior, the one that created me, God the Father, and made it all possible from the beginning. And I trust that you will too. So get your hearts right with the Lord. Keep your hearts right with the Lord. If you're not attending a church, get in some Bible preaching church, not any church. There's a lot of churches that don't cheat, that they don't teach the true gospel of Jesus Christ. You find a Bible believing church that preaches and teaches the true word of God, and you get in there and commit yourself to the Lord, and you work with those in that church and ask God to help you to be a light and a soul winner for him, and see what God will do in your life. He'll let you enjoy the rest of this life that you live on this earth. Oh, what a joy it is for me to live every day. It's pure joy for me. It was a pure joy. Many times I talked with Doug, and I'm not just picking up on that because I'm standing behind this podium saying that to you. But I can honestly tell you, when I talked to him, I never hung up and felt, man, I just feel bad talking to that guy. He's always down and just everything. I mean, he would always talk about something of the Lord, and we'd just get on the positive side. You know, I've heard ministers say, you know, there's a positive and negative that we have in our lives. And yeah, I don't like to dwell on the negatives. Amen. Push those things. Keep them covered out of the way. I want to dwell on the positive things. The things that are good and wholesome and pure and lovely and just and right. Amen. That's the things I want to. Things that are of good virtue and things that are of good praise. That's what I want to dwell on. Keep my mind on. And I trust that you will too. Because God loves you. He loves you, family. And he'll be with you every step of the way. And he's not finished with you. He's got a work for each of you to do. And if you hadn't found that work, I encourage you as a pastor and a minister today to seek him out and to find what work he has for you to do, and do it with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. Jesus said, when he was asked what was the greatest, you know, of the commandments, and he could have spelled back different ones. He could have spoke. He said, the two greatest commandments, he said, first is to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, mind, soul, and strength. Well, that just covered the Ten Commandments right there. And then he said, the second is to love your neighbor as you love yourself. I love myself this morning, but I got to love my neighbor. And sometimes people ain't lovable as others are in this world. They're not easy, Tasha, to love some. But I tell you what, with the Lord's help, you can love them. There's a lot of things that I don't like, you know, that some people do. But I'm supposed to love them. And I tell you, one of the best ways to love people is you start praying for them. Start praying for them. Start keeping them on your heart, praying, God, if they're not saved, save them. And if they're mean and ugly in some ways, God, help them to straighten up. Amen. Help them to straighten up and get right. Get things straight with you, Lord, so that they can be sweet like you want us to be. Thank you. Thank you, family. Thank you very much for allowing me to come and speak today. And I hope things that I said that the Lord give me. I only spoke what the Lord gave me, because I don't want to come behind this pulpit and this chapel and say anything that God would not have me to say that wouldn't be something of encouragement and hope and strength and something solid for you to grab a hold to and live by through the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank you. I thank you. He loves you today. Father, we do thank you, Lord. We thank you for the message of your word that you've given us to share. I pray that it's been received, Lord, with a good heart, on good soil, that your word has fell upon today, and that it will take root in the hearts of those that are here, God, and it will help those that are saved to even grow stronger and bigger, greater, and be recognized a more spiritual giant by others around them. And those that may be lost in this chapel today, I pray that they'll make that confession with their mouth and believe in their hearts that they would receive Christ as their Lord and their Savior. Yes, Father, we ask this in Jesus' name. Go with us now to the cemetery. Keep us, Lord, in thy care as we go. Amen.
The road is long.
It's a long, long road. From whence there is no return. While we're on the way to there, why not share? My brother.